a plane lands at JFK Airport. The lights all go out. There's no word from the pilots or the crew or from any of the passengers. The police, the army are called in. They surround the plane. And we actually did hire a 747 for a couple of weeks at Toronto Airport. And it's all set in Manhattan. And no one knows what's happening with this silent plane. And Abraham Setrakian, who I play, who is an elderly Jewish Holocaust survivor who's lived quietly in New York, in Harlem, running a slightly run-down pawnbroker shop for 30 or 40 years. I'm sure none of his neighbors know him very well. He's always kept himself to himself. And he's behind the counter of his shop. He sees all this happening on live TV news. And he knows on his little TV set, and he knows exactly what's happening. He goes down to his basement, and it's chock full of silver weapons, swords, sabers, silver nail guns that he's built himself over the years in preparation for this moment, because he seems to be the only person who knows what's really happening. So he has to get down to the airport to convince the authorities with great difficulty, because you've got an 80-year-old guy in a goatee beard, a trilby and a big overcoat and a walking stick that conceals a weapon of sorts. And he is stopped by the police, carted off to jail before he can convince anyone of exactly what's happening. So his mission is to, and it's a strain of vampirism that's hitting New York, and because of his history in the concentration camps, and because of what's happened to his wife, because of these creatures many years before, he's on a revenge mission to avenge her death and the death of his friends in the camps. But his hardest task is convincing everyone that this is what needs to be done, and his methods for getting rid of this strain of vampirism is rather extreme, and it's no wonder he has trouble convincing people. But he leads the charge. He convinces a couple of people who are involved in the in this infection that seems to be taking over, and the He kind of leads the charge, and gradually he assembles a small group of fellow travelers, so to speak, who will gradually come to realize that he's right, and that's how it goes on. Will they defeat the master? And the master has created this network of corruption. There are a lot of people who are in on it more than you realize at first. And I suppose it's a Faustian thing of the possibility of eternal life that brought people onto the side of the master that are going along with this, because it's something that fascinates everybody. Well, actually, the promise of eternal life, how much are you prepared to pay personally and financially, whatever, to achieve this? So he's not only fighting to contain this this strain, he's also fighting to overcome the odds stacked against him in terms of people who are standing in his way. So that's the basic premise.